Tonight, Ukraine faced the kind of strike no radar could fully prepare for. No warning, just the sudden collapse of light, the roar of engines, and impacts that came faster than anyone could react. Glide bombs from Su-34 jets, KH-101 missiles from two 160 bombers, and a hypersonic Oreshnik descending at impossible speed. This is how the night turned against Ukraine. In recent weeks, Ukrainians have learned again what it means when the night sky turns into a battlefield. Sirens rise over cities like Kyiv, Dnipro, Odesa, and Kharkiv. The first thing to fail is often the light. Streets go black, apartment blocks lose power and heating, and tens of thousands of people suddenly sit in freezing darkness because a substation or power plant has just been hit by a Russian missile or drone. In one of the latest waves, more than 600 drones and dozens of missiles tore into Ukraine's energy network, cutting electricity to over 500,000 people in and around the capital and knocking out heat for tens of thousands more in the south. Behind the headlines about massive airstrikes, there is a quieter, more technical story: the evolution of Russia's strike tools. Three of them stand out because of what they represent on different layers of the war. Near the front line, the Su-34 strike fighter drops gigantic FAB-1500 bombs converted into precision glide weapons, pulverizing trenches, warehouses, and even whole city blocks. Far behind the front, two 160 strategic bombers launch strings of KH-101 cruise missiles from hundreds of kilometers away, slipping low over the terrain toward power stations and industrial hubs. And at the very top of the threat ladder sits Oreshnik, a new hypersonic intermediate-range ballistic missile, nuclear-capable, tested in secret for years and used in combat for the first time when it slammed into a major defense plant in Dnipro in November 2024. To understand why these systems are so frightening, you have to look at what the Su-34 and its FAB-1500 bombs have become. At the start of the war, Russia dropped huge numbers of old, unguided, dumb bombs. Over time, engineers strapped cheap UMPK guidance kits and folding wings onto Soviet-era FAB-500 and FAB-1500 bombs, turning them into glide weapons that can travel 40 to 70 kilometers or more from the release point. A FAB-1500 carries roughly 1.5 tons of explosive. When a Su-34 drops one from high altitude, the bomb glides toward GPS-guided coordinates and hits with enough force to collapse large reinforced buildings, crack concrete bunkers, and erase defensive positions in a single strike. Analysts and Ukrainian sources report that Russia now drops thousands of glide bombs a month, primarily from Su-34s, using them as systematic preparatory fires before ground assaults. For Ukrainian troops in a frontline town, the experience is brutal. There is often little warning. The Su-34 never has to cross far into Ukrainian airspace, staying behind its own lines or over the sea, outside the engagement envelope of many Ukrainian surface-to-air systems. Radar may pick up the aircraft and the glide bombs, but not every sector has long-range air defense ready, and there are more bombs than interceptors. A single FAB-1500 can level an apartment block that has been turned into a strong point or a factory used as a logistics hub. Even if only a fraction gets through, entire neighborhoods on the edge of the front can be turned into dust and twisted rebar. On a different scale altogether, the Tu-160 White Swan operates as a flying missile truck. This large supersonic bomber can carry up to 12 KH-101 cruise missiles on internal rotary launchers, each designed to fly hundreds or even thousands of kilometers at low altitude, following the contours of the terrain. In multiple large-scale strikes against Ukraine, Tu-95MS and Tu-160 bombers have been loaded close to their maximum KH-101 load and launched from deep inside Russian territory, sometimes over the Arctic or the Caspian, far beyond the reach of Ukrainian air defense. For people on the ground, a KH-101 attack is experienced as a series of waves. First come the air raid warnings and the distant thump of air defense batteries firing. Then, in the darkness, there are flashes on the horizon as some missiles are intercepted, followed by sudden fireballs when one gets through. A transformer station, a gas facility, a CHP plant, or a residential block sitting too close to critical infrastructure. In the huge November 2025 energy strikes, cruise missiles and drones together forced rolling blackouts across multiple regions and left power generation at or near zero at times, according to Ukrainian officials. Strategically, this is not just about destroying targets. It is about exhausting Ukraine's stock of expensive SAM interceptors, breaking the reliability of the grid, and increasing pressure on civilians as winter sets in. Above both of these layers sits Oreshnik, and its very design is meant to send a message. Open sources and Western officials describe it as an intermediate-range ballistic missile derived from the RS-26 Rubej program, with a speed exceeding Mach 10 and a range in the thousands of kilometers. Unlike other missiles Russia has used in this war, Oreshnik carries a MIRV payload, multiple independently targetable re-entry vehicles, each with its own guidance, and each reportedly containing a cluster of submunitions. When Russia used it for the first time in November 2024 to hit the Pivdenmash facility in Dnipro, observers noted that this was the first combat employment of a MIRV ballistic missile in history. In practical terms, a missile like Oreshnik compresses time to almost nothing for anyone under its trajectory. From launch to impact can be a matter of minutes, not tens of minutes, and instead of one large warhead, the target area faces several incoming re-entry vehicles arriving at extreme speed. Ballistic missile defense systems are designed to counter such threats, but Ukraine's network is sparse, built from a mix of Soviet-era components and a small number of modern batteries supplied by partners. Analysts at think tanks like CSIS and Carnegie note that this kind of weapon is exceptionally challenging for Ukraine to stop with its current inventory, and its nuclear-capable nature makes any use of it a form of strategic signaling toward NATO as much as a purely military act. When you put these three systems together, Su-34 with FAB-1500 glide bombs, Tu-160 with KH-101 and Oreshnik, you get a picture of layered strike warfare. A hypothetical coordinated attack could begin with one or more Oreshnik launches against a high-value industrial or command facility, not only to damage it, but to demonstrate that Russia is willing to use an IRBM with MIRVs in the theater. Almost simultaneously, Tu-160s and Tu-95MS from the deep rear could release volleys of KH-101s toward power plants, substations, and transport hubs, while swarms of drones saturate Ukrainian radar. As Ukraine's air defenses focus on the long-range threat and its grid struggles under new disruptions, Su-34s at closer range drop FAB-1500 UMPK bombs on frontline cities, brigades assembling for counterattacks, or ammunition depots. The result of such a scenario would not simply be more explosions, it would mean overlapping pressure on three different levels of Ukraine's defense: strategic deterrence at the top, national infrastructure in the middle, and tactical survival at the front. Civilians would feel it as blackouts, destroyed neighborhoods, and renewed fear that the war is escalating into something even harder to control. Ukrainian forces would feel it as increased difficulty moving reserves and supplies, defending fixed positions, and keeping high-end air defense systems alive. None of these weapons guarantees victory for Russia. Many military experts emphasize that glide bombs and cruise missiles can terrorize and destroy, but they cannot by themselves occupy territory or solve Russia's manpower problems on the ground. Yet as long as the war continues, the Su-34 with FAB-1500 glide bombs, the Tu-160 with KH-101, and the Oreshnik YRBM represent three different ways Moscow can try to reshuffle the balance of fear. For analysts and viewers, understanding how these systems work is not about glorifying them. It is about understanding why Ukrainian cities go dark overnight, why frontline towns are reduced to rubble in a single day, and why every new missile test in Russia now carries a political message aimed far beyond Ukraine's borders.